today I choose to follow you. Today I choose to give my yes to you. Today I choose to hear your voice and live. Today for me and my house, we will serve you. As for me and my house, we will spend our lives on you today. Everlasting Father, eternal King, Lord of hosts, willingly we follow. Your wonderful Counselor, Everlasting Father, eternal King, Lord of hosts, willingly we follow. Today I choose to give my yes to you. Today I choose to hear your voice and live. Today I choose to follow you, to follow you.
Good morning. Good to see people here this morning. We're going to invite you to stand as we open up our worship service this morning. Oh, daily walking close to thee, let it be. Dear Lord, let it be. I am weak, but thou art strong. Oh, Jesus, keep me from all wrong. And I'll be satisfied as long as I walk. Let me walk close to thee. Just a closer walk with thee. Oh, granted, Jesus is my plea. And walking close to thee, let it be. Oh, dear Lord, let it be.
Through this world of toil and snares, give
closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea, and daily walking close to thee. Is o'er. Time for me will be no more, and guide me gently, safely o'er to thy kingdom shore, to thy shore. Just a closer walk with thee. Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. And daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be.
Let's just bow in a word of prayer this morning. Loving God, we do thank you again for another beautiful day. We can just look at your work, your handiwork that you've created, and we thank you so much for the country we live in, that we're able to gather here together, that we have the freedom, and we just pray that we will be able to maintain that going forward, and as this lifts and we have more people gathered together, that that would just be just a great thing to come back together and corporately worship you just together. We pray for those out on the, wherever they're at, whether it's a time of rest, relaxation, or at home, we just pray that you would be with them and that you would meet them here this morning as well through the online service or whatever that might look like. We pray for Pastor Kevin as he brings us the message this morning, that we would prepare our hearts and minds for that. We want to set all distractions aside. We want to continue to pray for those who are in more challenging situations than we are right now, our missionaries or others that are dealing with persecution just because of their faith or trying to spread the word that you have, just the freedom in that. We just pray that you would be with them. Wrap your arms around them. Just know that there's a group praying and supporting them. We pray for those who are might be bound because of illness or dealing with loss in a time when it's hard to be together. We just pray you would be with them, surround them, and know that there is your love that is there for them as well. We continue to worship this morning, and we do it with grateful hearts, and we pray this in your precious name. Amen. As we continue to support one another, I'm going to invite you to here. We can look around and give that welcoming nod. But if you're out in a different land here, we want to invite you to send a quick text and just encourage one another. And that's what we're to do as we support each other through this.
Hallelujah, 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 your love makes me sing. Hallelujah, 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 your love makes me sing. Your love is amazing, steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain firm beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you gently lift me. When I am surrounded, your love carries me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. You're amazing. is amazing, steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain firm beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you gently lift me. When I am surrounded, your love carries me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Oh, yes, you make me sing. Lord, you make me sing.
I'm going to read Proverbs 16, verses 1 to 9. To humans belong the plans of the heart, but from the Lord comes the proper answer of the tongue. All a person's ways seem pure to them, but motives are weighed by the Lord. Commit to the Lord whatever you do, and he will establish your plans. The Lord works out everything to its proper end, even the wicked for a day of disaster. The Lord detests all the proud of heart. Be sure of this. They will not go unpunished. Through love and faithfulness, sin is atoned for. Through the fear of the Lord, evil is avoided. When the Lord takes pleasure in anyone's way, he causes their enemies to make peace with them. Better a little with righteousness than much gain with injustice. In their hearts, humans plan their course, but the Lord establishes their steps.
On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trying on Jesus' name. On Christ's solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
When darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. My anchor holds within the veil.
On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath, his covenant, his blood support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, he then shall be my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh my, I then in him be found. In his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. I will follow you. All your ways are good, all your ways are sure. I will trust in you alone, higher than my sight, high above my life. I will trust in you alone, in you alone. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Whom you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. I will follow you.
Light into the world, light into my life. I will live for you alone. You're the one I seek, knowing I will find all I need in you alone, in you alone.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Whom you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. I will follow you. Life everlasting in you. There's freedom for my soul. In you there is joy, unending joy. In you there is life everlasting. In you there is freedom for my soul. In you there's joy, unending joy. You stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Whom you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. I will follow you. I will follow you.
Please be seated.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I want to welcome you to our worship service this morning, and for the fathers here, wish you happy Father's Day or happy barbecued steak day, whichever it turns out to be. I know that's what it'll be at my house today. Or maybe I shouldn't say that. I'll end up with some visitors, but that's okay. If that's the case, we'll just cut the steak smaller. Or there was somebody in the Bible that it just kind of, as they kept serving it, it kept coming. So who knows what would take place. But anyways, happy Father's Day, and we're glad for that you're able to join us this morning, whether it be here in person or on our live feed. Now I'm going to have to get used to things a little differently again. For quite a while, I've had a number of you saying, look, Pastor, when you're making a point, look at the camera, right? You kept telling me that. Look, Pastor, when you're making a point, look at the camera, and it's a small thing way in the back of the room. So now it doesn't really grab my attention at all. So I've really worked hard at trying to look at the camera when I'm talking and preaching. So now that we've got people back in the building, I got to learn to do both of them. So I guess there's always something to learn, and that's okay. We have a lot of announcements this morning, different things that are going on in the life of our church we want to touch on. Blast, I believe, is still meeting this week. Check with your leaders on that. Our youth group, now that we are opened up more, our youth group is going to have an end-of-the-year outdoor party. And so you should have received an email related to that, and the email outlines where it is and the Alberta Health guidelines that are being followed for it. So please, if you haven't received that email, get in touch with Beth and or call the office here, and we will get that information to you. But that is this Tuesday at 6:30 to 9 this Tuesday night. So that's the youth group. We'll be having an end-of-the-year outdoor party with all of the sanitizing stations and physical distancing and all that kind of stuff. They've worked hard to plan that all out. Discoveryland, our children's ministry as a church, what is that going to look like during the summer? Well, July 5th, we are going to begin with some children's ministry again within our church building. It will look different than it has in the past, and this will be part of our summer. And then as we move into stage three as a province, we will revisit some of that come September. But for July and August, what we are looking at is ages 3 to 6 are going to get dismissed during the sermon time to go downstairs for their time. They're set up in different classrooms and groups, and they're doing all the social distancing and disinfecting and all of that that's required. We're expected to follow the day camp protocols as we open up our children's ministry as a church, and so that's what they're looking at doing down there. We're not going to have parents aren't able to go down the stairs. Basically, the kids will get either dismissed from here or dropped off at the top of the stairs so that we can limit the number of people that are down there. But that's going to start on July the 5th. Each of them are going to have their own activity box that will get disinfected weekly and restocked and all of that. And from that activity box, the Discoveryland leaders will be doing different sessions and different stations with the those that are age 3 to 6. Those that are age 7 to 11, there's going to be an activity box for them to bring into the church service. So that will have their they'll put their name on it, and they will leave it here at the end of the service, and then it'll get disinfected and restocked with whatever it is for the following week. And they've got some different contests and different ideas set for that. Some of them might even be to see if some of them are paying attention to the sermon, and if they can get enough notes down there to know what the pastor was talking about, they may get some prizes with that as well. So those are some of the things that will be planned, and that's going to start on July the 5th. So July the 5th, there'll be activity boxes for our kids here that are in the service, and there will be Discoveryland for ages 3 to 6 downstairs. I've got lots on my list here, so where to begin? This week will be the last Zoom Bible study on Wednesday night, and then that will shut down. Giving, as we begin to move back into having people in the building, for those of you who are not active in online giving or e-transfer giving, there is a box sitting at the back, and we won't be passing that around anymore for the time being, but there's a box at the back where that can go as well. For those who are giving through online giving, on our Facebook link, you can see the email address for our e-transfers and such that are taking place there. Nursery, unfortunately, is still not available during this time in stage two, and we'll see what happens with that as it goes forward. Two other things here. One, as we begin to gather as a church, some of you are wondering what it is when you come through the door and what we are doing here. As you come through the door, we ask that you use a hand sanitizer as you come through the door. It's encouraged for you to use it as you exit. But as you come through the door, please use a hand sanitizer. There are masks available for those of you who wish. They are not mandatory. They are encouraged during congregational singing just out of respect for the seniors we have present here or those that might be in that more vulnerable category as well. So those are available. They're not mandatory, but they are encouraged during our congregational singing. When we finish our service, we would ask that you do your visiting outside the building. We're going to have this door open for those of you who are looking at simply wanting to leave without bumping into other people. That door will be open for that as well. But we are encouraging it's part of what Alberta Health is recommending for us, that after we finish gathering as our worship service, that any visiting that takes place outside of the building. Last thing, we are looking for a volunteer. We have had some very faithful people working in our sound and in our media booths over this last season. We've got some people that have been trained in that area as well, but we are in need of one more. So we're looking for someone who would volunteer to either be part of doing sound for our services or be willing to look after our media. We're going to continue with our online streaming indefinitely, so we are looking for a volunteer to help with that. If you are interested in that, please either contact the church office or contact Kyle Rosendahl, and he will give you the information required with that. So I think that's the longest announcement session I have had in 3 months. We're going to continue worshiping through singing here in a moment. But before we do so, I would just invite us to join together as we worship God in prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. I thank you for this morning where we can gather both in person and online and be your people. We come before you to worship because you are God. You are worthy. You are awesome in power, holiness, might, and you are our creator. And we come before you longing to connect with you and worship you. Lord, you have told us that the greatest of all commandments is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. Lord, that we love you with our all. And we come here this morning wishing to express that in the way we worship you. Father, I pray for our congregation this morning, that there are those in our congregation I know who are struggling through various challenges, whether it be health challenges or economic challenges or relational challenges or just in their own spirit. Father, we recognize that we live in a world that challenges our faith and sometimes leaves us with questions and temptations and struggles. And I pray, Father, that as that touches us as a people and touches us as your people in this congregation, we pray that your Holy Spirit would continue to draw close to us and work in our lives. I pray, Father, that you would help us not to still the voice of your Spirit when you, through your word and by your Spirit, choose to speak to us, to convict us of need to draw close to you. That, Lord, where you go, we will go. Where you will stay, we will stay. I pray, Father, for those going through those kinds of challenges in their life, that you would give us, your people, eyes to see, that we might encourage one another and support one another in this faith that we share together. Lord, be glorified through your people as we worship you. In Jesus' name.
Can invite you to stand as we continue to worship. And just on a side note, as we dismiss, we encourage you, there will be the door, but just as we, you know, there's rows. So, you know, you kind of like as you do with weddings, funerals, whatever, just watch the progression of people in front of you as you funnel out there and funnel to this door. And that way we can maintain a little bit of that distancing. I invite you to stand with us. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. Even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near. I won't fear no evil, for my God is with me. If my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Oh no, you never let go, through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go, in every high and every low. Oh no, you never let go, Lord, you never let go of me.
Troubles, but until that day comes, we'll live to know you here on the earth. I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me,
I can see a light that is coming for the heart that holds on. There will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, still I will praise you, still I will praise you. Yes, I can see a light that is coming for the heart that holds on. There will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, still I will praise you, still I will praise you. And oh no, you never let go through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go in every high and every low. Oh no, you never let go, Lord, you never let go of me. And oh no, you never let go through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go in every high and every low. Oh no, you never let go, Lord, you never let go of me.
Genesis 13. So Abram went up from Egypt to the Negev with his wife and everything he had, and Lot went with him. Abram had become very wealthy in livestock and in silver and gold. From the Negev he went from place to place until he came to Bethel, to the place between Bethel and Ai, where his tent had been earlier, and where he had first built an altar. There Abram called on the name of the Lord. Now Lot, who was moving about with Abram, also had flocks and herds and tents. But the land could not support them while they stayed together, for their possessions were so great that they were not able to stay together. And quarreling arose between Abram's herders and Lot's. The Canaanites and the Perizzites were also giving living in the land at the time. So Abram said to Lot, "Let's not have any quarreling between you and me, or between your herders and mine, for we are close relatives. Is not the whole land before you? Let's part company. If you go to the left, I'll go to the right. If you go to the right, I'll go to the left." Lot looked around and saw that the whole plain of Jordan toward Zoar was well watered, like the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt. This was before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. So Lot chose for himself the whole plain of the Jordan and set out toward the east. The two men parted company. Abram lived in the land of Canaan, while Lot lived among the cities of the plain and pitched his tents near Sodom. Now the people of Sodom were wicked and were sinning greatly against the Lord. The Lord said to Abram after Lot had parted from him, "Look around from where you are, to the north and south, to the east and west. All the land that you see I will give to you and your offspring forever. I will make your offspring like the dust of the earth, so that if anyone could count the dust, then your offspring could be counted. Go walk through the length and breadth of the land, for I am giving it to you." So Abram went to live near the great trees of Mamre at Hebron, where he pitched his tents. There he built an altar to the Lord.
Every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mountain fixed upon it, Mount of thy redeeming love.
Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy help I come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood.
Oh, your kindness yet pursues me, how your mercy never fails me. Till that day that death shall lose me, I will sing, oh, I will sing. Oh, to grace how dead a debtor, daily I'm constrained to be. Let the goodness like a fetter bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts above. How your kindness yet pursues me, how your mercy never fails me. Till that day that death shall lose me, I will sing, oh, I will sing. How your kindness yet pursues me, how your mercy never fails me. Till that day that death shall lose me, I will sing, oh, I will sing. Till that day that death shall lose me, I will sing, oh, I will sing.
Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love.
Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back.
One more time.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back.
Please be seated.
So this morning, as we continue to worship through God's Word, we're in Genesis chapter 13, continuing with the life of Abraham. And the title of the message this morning is The Decisions That We Make. I want to begin this morning with a question. What kind of thought do we put into the long-range implications of some of the decisions we make? We make a lot of decisions every day, some of them big, some of them little. But what kind of thought do we put into the long-range implications of some of the decisions we make? And the question came to me sort of, and you've probably had this experience before. Occasionally I've considered whether it's people that I've known, or sometimes it's, you know, you're reading some news article about where are they now articles, right? And you hear about different celebrities and things that have happened to them. And, you know, some of the stories are good stories, but many of the stories you come across are kind of like, what on earth happened? How did that take place? How did they end up, given all the advantages they had at certain junctures in their life and career, how did they end up in that place with such a sad ending? The Lord Jesus talked about some of the implications of the decisions that we make on a number of occasions. He talked on one occasion about how there's two gates or two roads. One is wide and easy, the other is narrow and hard. And the choice that we make, though, has two different outcomes to it. Another occasion, he talked about two houses built by two men. One was oceanfront property on a sandy shore. The other, well, you know the story. The storm hit them both, and only the one whose earlier decisions created a firm foundation still had a roof over his head. Jesus said this, "Everyone then who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on a rock." The firm foundation had to do with decisions that are made out of faith. And you and I, in the decisions we make, whether they be large decisions or small ones, we make them through a filter. We make them or through a lens. We make decisions that are either made through our faith and out of our faith in Jesus Christ and the life he calls us to make, or we make decisions that are not out of faith. We've been talking about faith the last number of weeks, faith leaning into God, responding to God's initiative. Faith at its most basic sense is obedience to God. This morning, as we look at this Bible account, we're going to actually take a lot of scripture this morning and an aerial view. Some of it I'm going to come back to on other Sundays. We're going to look at Genesis chapter 13 and 14 and then again at chapters 18 and 19. This morning's Bible account, as we continue to look at the life of Abram, the life of Abraham, looks at the decisions of two men, Abram and Lot, And as we look at the decisions made by these two men, Abram and Lot, the passage invites us to consider where leads the decisions we make. Where leads the decisions we make? And in many senses, as I've been preparing this message this week, it is perhaps one of the more cautionary sermons that will come out of this study of the life of Abraham. Maybe one of the more difficult sermons to look at. It's a story of the decisions, and sometimes we don't understand the implications in the moment that we happen to be in. But I pray this morning as we look at this passage is an opportunity for us to give pause to where our faith or the absence of our faith reaches in the decisions that we make. Where leads the decisions we make? So if you have your Bibles, we're in Genesis chapter 13, continuing on with the story of Abram. And we're taking a look this morning, really at a conflict that he experienced. Now, Abram, as we have followed his life to this date, Abram has returned to Canaan. This is the land of promise that God called him out of Ur to. God's calling on Abram's life was to leave the land that he was in, and God called him out of this polytheistic worship setting, and he made a promise to Abram that I'm going to make you into a great nation. He says, I'm going to give you this land, and this promise, they're revealed in different successions throughout his life. But Abram, he left Ur, he went to Haran, which we saw was the halfway place of his experience in following God. He went from there and he made the decision to go to Canaan, which is where God was calling him to be, the land of promise. And last week we looked at the obstacles to living by faith. When God calls you, when God puts a call on your life, and God puts a call on all of our lives, when God puts a call on our life, and we make the decision to follow him, to go to Canaan, so to speak, we will find that there are obstacles to living by faith. And no sooner did Abram arrive in Canaan than he found out that there was a famine in the land. And so last week, we took a look at responding to the obstacles to living out our faith in God. Abraham responded to those obstacles last week without faith. And he decided to go down to Egypt instead. He responded to God without faith. He responded with a humanistic, pragmatic solution. And so we looked a little bit last Sunday about how not only are we called to follow Jesus by faith, to enter into the land by faith, we're called to remain there by faith as well. Quoted Charles Swindoll last Sunday, when he said this, God does not use difficult circumstances to find out what we'll do. He already knows. He uses tests to reveal us to ourselves. He uses tests to reveal us to ourselves. And we get to ask the question, where does my faith need to grow? Where does my faith need to grow? You know, and sometimes we think it should get easier in time, don't we? I mean, I've been a Christian for 38 years, and I think I've walked with God through all different obstacles. And all different decisions. Shouldn't it be easier? But that's part of how faith grows, is God continues to bring you into places where you have not yet learned to trust him yet. And so we end up at spots where we go, you know what? This should be easier, but it's not, because God is still reaching into the parts of our heart and life to help us to live by faith in new places that we haven't yet been. Abram returns from Egypt, and he begins again by faith to remain within the call of God on his life. There will be famines in the land, but God does not abandon us when obstacles arise to follow him. We needn't return to a secular way of managing life apart from faith when we encounter obstacles. Rather, we continue in the faith that has brought us to the place we are at now. So with that, we go into chapter 13, and we find as we enter chapter 13, Abram is back in the land of Canaan, and a new obstacle arises. A new obstacle arises, and this time, it's the obstacle of conflict. Specifically, conflict amongst his own, between himself and his household, that of his nephew Lot. Now, Lot's story is an interesting one. We're going to look at various parts of Lot's story this morning. Lot's father had died in Ur before Abram was even called to leave Ur. And as Lot's father had died in Ur, apparently, it seems that he attached himself to Abram as a father figure. And he follows Abram from Ur to Haran. He follows Abram to Canaan. He followed Abram to Egypt. And then he followed Abram back to Canaan. And during this time, both Abram and Lot have become wealthy, wandering herdsmen. They don't have any land of their own. They don't really have a home yet in Canaan, but they've both become very wealthy. And so we come to where it is in chapter 13, verse 2. Now, Abram was very rich in livestock, in silver and in gold, and he journeyed on from the Negev as far as Bethel to the place where his tent had been at the beginning, between Bethel and Ai, and to the place where he had made an altar at the first. And there Abram called upon the name of the Lord. Now this is interesting. This I could preach a whole sermon. In fact, I have preached a whole sermon on these verses before. Abram returns, and I like where he returns to. Now if you've been reading at all in Abram's life, if you've been reading these chapters in Genesis at all during the week, you'll have noticed that along the way as he arrives in Canaan, he connects with God. He seeks to vitalize his relationship with God. He has built certain places, certain altars where he has met with God. In this portion of scripture here, he returns. He returns to the beginning of his journey with God in Canaan. And I think there's a significant lesson in there. It's not the main one that I have for this morning, but it speaks about the maturing in Abram's faith and the newfound contentment that he has in God. He has left Egypt. He has returned to Canaan. And when he returns to Canaan, he goes and he sets his tent up in the places that he has met with God before. And there's an important lesson in there for us as believers. I couldn't help but think of Jesus' words in Revelation chapter 2, verse 5. He's talking to the church in Ephesus, and he tells them, remember from where you have fallen, repent and do the works that you did at first. When we find ourselves in situations where we've made the wrong decisions in the obstacles to our faith, and that's what took place in Abram's life last week as we looked at it. He shouldn't have gone down to Egypt. Or if he had, he should have started with God rather than figuring out a humanistic, secular solution to his problem. Now he has returned to Canaan, and what does he do? He returns to the place that he began. Remember from where you have fallen, repent and do the works that you did at first. Dear people, if you find yourself in a place where you have been struggling with following God and you've made that decision to return, you might be left with a now what question. The now what question after you veered off a course and you returned to God. Abram gives us a good example of what we can do. Return to the life you were living at the last juncture of your faith. When you were living by faith and you took a side trip, return to that place and carry on from there. This is what Abram does. He returns to the life he was living at the last juncture of faith before he veered off in the obstacle we looked at last week. But then we come to verse 5 and it says, and Lot. And we're introduced to a new obstacle to Abram living out God's call on his life. And Lot, and there was strife. Now it's interesting when you take a look at the obstacles that Abram experiences. Abram's last faith challenge that we looked at last week was in the presence of famine. The faith challenge before him this week is in the presence of prosperity. And this leads to family conflict. And Lot, in verse 5, was there, who went with Abram, also had flocks and herds and tents, so that the land could not support both of them dwelling together, for their possessions were so great that they could not dwell together. And there was strife between the herdsmen. Abram's response to this challenge of faith says a lot about how he's been growing in his faith. Abram says to Lot, let there be no strife between you and me. And Abram, who is the recipient of the promise of God. Abram is the one that God has said to you, I'm sending you to this land. Lot is in the land as well. Abram, though recipient of that promise, he surrenders his choice. He surrenders his choice. He could easily have looked at Lot and said, hey, look, you know what? This whole journey started with God and me. You go truck someplace else. I'm taking first pick. But it's interesting what takes place in Abram's life. There's a surrender that takes place. There's a, you know what? God is going to make the way. God is going to open the door for me. I don't have to enter into conflict the way everybody else enters into conflict. I don't have to enter into conflict thinking about I need to grab and I need to retain my own. I need to make sure I have my position, my rights, my me. Instead, Abram enters into this conflict and his faith speaks into it. He says, you know what? God's got this. God's got this. God who called me is the God who will sustain me, and God is the one that will be at work in the midst of this. And he surrenders. He surrenders his choice. He surrenders trusting God who brought him there. Now, yes, sometimes when we're in the face of a problem, we may aggressively pursue something. And sometimes God calls us to push. I think of Paul and his missionary journeys that God called him into. There was an endurance, and he went forward in that. But sometimes the right course is to quietly wait upon God. Sometimes it is to wait and to say, God, I'm going to surrender my rights, my expectations, my entitlements, even the legitimate ones. I'm going to surrender them to you and let you speak into this. One of the vivid experiences for that for me was earlier, was in 1994, and I was working as a mechanic in Saskatoon. We'd been married for a few years, and I believed that God was calling me into pastoral ministry. And at that point in time, I was serving on a church board and teaching adult Sunday school class and was active in various ministries in my local church, and believed that God was calling me towards pastoral ministry. And part of that is the decision to go to Bible school, the decision to go to Bible college and to experience that training as such to that. Call in the ministry was taking place, and as Carla and I were discussing it, there was conflict in the home. She did not want to be a pastor's wife. She had grown up with missionary experience. She had hoped one day we would maybe be missionaries someplace. Her family had often been close to pastoral families and seen some of the deeper inside things. I mean, there's a lot of joys and blessings that come within being a pastor, but there are also some very difficult and painful moments as well. And with that, she did not want anything to do with that. And we had conflict. Said, I want to quit my job and I want to go and apply to Bible school. Let's go and do this. I believe this is where God is moving us. And we fought about this. Here's a spiritual thing. Let's talk about ministry and let's scrap over it. I remember it came at one point as I was before God. There was this sense, there are spiritual gifts that God has put in my life that don't require, I mean, I don't have to be a pastor to preach. I don't have to be a pastor to teach. I don't have to be a pastor to do these things. And I remember sitting there one day, and it was before God saying, you know what, but I've made a vow, and my marriage matters. And that day I surrendered that whole sense of call to God and said, you know what? I'm going to put my heart into my work at the shop. I'm going to put my heart into what God has given me in my local church and those ministries. And I dropped it. I left it there. And it was a moment, it was a very particular moment of surrender before God. It was maybe a few weeks to a month after that. We didn't talk about it at all anymore. Maybe a few weeks to a month after that. That Carla came to me completely out of nowhere. She looked at me and said, I think you need to go to Bible school. Now, if you ask her the rest of the story, she will probably tell you that she figured that God would change my direction at Bible school and we would end up on the mission field. That isn't what happened. But there was a turning point in that conflict that happened with surrender. Having the faith to surrender something to God and say, I give this to you. And where this leads, it is up to you. Abram faced this conflict with Lot with faith. He surrendered to God. He trusted God. And he diffused the conflict by saying, Lot, you decide. I release what happens here to you. Abram made a decision out of his faith. Lot made a decision from a different place. Take a look at what happens here in verse 10. And Lot lifted up his eyes and saw that the Jordan Valley was well watered everywhere, like the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt in the direction of Zoar. This was before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. So Lot chose for himself all the Jordan Valley, and Lot journeyed east. Thus they separated from each other. Abram settled in the land of Canaan, while Lot settled among the cities of the valley and moved his tent as far as Sodom. Now the men of Sodom were wicked and great sinners against the Lord. There's a little bit of foreshadowing that's taking place at this point in the biblical text. Lot made a decision here, but Lot's decision was not out of faith. Lot's decision was not out of surrender to God. Lot's decision was based out of self-interest and even out of greed. He looked to the east and he saw the Jordan Valley. He saw the potential to increase his wealth. And he made that decision. But he also saw something else. Five cities, one of them Sodom, that had a reputation. They all knew what Sodom was about. It was a place of wickedness. It was a place of immorality. It was a place of sin. And Lot seems to have made a decision that pulled him in the direction of a well-known wickedness in the land. Verses 14 to 18 go on, and it's God's reaffirmation to Abram and Abram's contentment with God. And we'll come back to Abram again on another Sunday. But what I want you to see here, because this leads into what follows. Where leads the decisions that we make? And you and I make decisions all the time. Do we make the decisions out of a place of faith, or do we make decisions out of a place of self-interest? Because the implications of those decisions years down the road take us to very different places in life. I wanted to give you a quick summary of the story of Lot. It's an aerial view. Trust if you go read chapter 13 and 14 and 18 and 19 later. I'm not going to go through and read them in detail, but I want to give you an aerial view of what happens from here. Story of Lot, two men and the basis of two decisions. Chapter 14 comes, and we find that Lot is living not near Sodom, but within Sodom. And there's a conflict that happens, this war, both tribal wars take place, these various kings, it breaks out. And during this time, Lot is captured. Sodom actually loses this skirmish, and Lot is carried away. He is captured. It says in verse 11 and 12, so the enemy took all the possessions of Sodom and Gomorrah and all the provisions and went their way. They also took Lot, the son of Abram's brother, who was dwelling in Sodom, and his possessions, and went their way. So what happens in the rest of chapter 14? Word comes to Abram. Abram, who has been continued to live by faith in the land, and there's different stories that happen with Abram after that. But he puts together a rescue party, and he goes and he rescues Lot. Actually, all of them got rescued. So much so that the king of Sodom said, you know what? Let me reward you with all of these riches. And Abram's response in verse 21 to 23 of chapter 13 or 14 says, and the king of Sodom said to Abram, give me the persons, but take the goods for yourself. But Abram said to the king of Sodom, I have lifted my hand to the Lord God, God Most High, possessor of heaven and earth, that I would not take a thread or a sandal strap or anything that is yours, lest you should say, I have made Abram rich. He was not going to be able to point to Sodom and their reputation and say, Sodom is what prospered me. What happens to Lot? Well, he remains in Sodom. We go ahead in the story. We go ahead about 20 to 25 years. We come to Genesis chapter 18. God appears to Abram. And it's an interesting, there's a sidebar here. There's something in theology called a theophany. And that's a pre-incarnate appearance of Christ. We know the incarnation of Christ through the Christmas story. God was made man. Well, there's a number of places in the scripture, in the Old Testament, where God appeared as a man, where Christ appeared as a pre-incarnate appearance of Christ. And this is one of them. God appears to Abram with some promises. He has two men who are angels with him. And while he's there, he warns Abram that he's going to bring judgment to Sodom and Gomorrah. Verse 20 of chapter 18 says this. We'll go to verse 20. Then the Lord said, because the outcry against Sodom and Gomorrah is great and their sin is very grave, I will go down to see whether they have done altogether according to the outcry that has come to them. God decides to tell Abram, this is what I'm planning to do. I am planning to bring judgment on Sodom and Gomorrah. He says, the sin and the wickedness that is there is such that he was not, basically God's coming on the scene and saying, enough, enough. You're not going to behave like this anymore. There's a story of intercession we'll come back to on another Sunday here. Abraham, at that point his name is changed to Abraham. He pleads with God. There's a story, it's a humorous story actually. Abraham looks at God and it's a story of intercession. He says, God, if there are 50 righteous people in Sodom, would you spare it? And God says, yes, if there are 50 righteous people, if there's 50 remnant people, righteous people, I will spare Sodom. And the story goes on rather humorously, and Abram goes, well, Lord, what if there's 5 that are lacking? What if instead of 55 are lacking, there's 45? Will you still spare it? And Abram continues to intercede. All the time, I believe Abram's thinking about his nephew Lot. He knows where Lot has gone. He knows where Lot is living. He knows what's taken place, something in Lot's life. And he, like many a parent who has wondered about a child who has wandered away, he intercedes to God. Finally, the Lord says to Abram, if there be only 10 righteous there, for the sake of 10, I will not destroy it. We come to chapter 19, verse 1. And it begins this way. The two angels came to Sodom in the evening, and Lot was sitting in the gate of Sodom. Now the story goes on there. Lot actually tries to protect these two men. There's something of righteousness that still remains in Lot. But he has such twisted thinking that takes place. I'm not going to go into the details of chapter 19. Chapter 19 is one of those R-rated passages of the Bible. When you go through and you read what takes place, when you live in Sodom long enough, the way you think changes. Your values, your understanding of what's right and wrong changes. And I mean, you read chapter 19, you go, what on earth was he thinking? What was he thinking? Is something changed? Something changed. You know how it is with us, right? First you're shocked, then you're tolerant, and then you accept and participate. And that's what happens even in our own lives, in our own land, when there's wickedness in our own land. The late Ruth Graham, wife to the late Billy Graham, was once quoted in saying, she was talking about America, the United States, but I think it can apply to many of our Western places. She once said, tongue in cheek, if God does not judge America, he will need to apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah. We don't see it because our thinking changes in the midst of unrighteousness. Lot is sitting at the gate. What that means, or it's that symbolic, and it speaks of something. He is now fully enmeshed into the life of Sodom. He's part of their decision making. He's part of those who sit at the gate and make decisions. I want you to see the progression that takes place here. I want you to see the progression that takes place. Where do our decisions lead? Where leads the decisions we make? In chapter 13, verse 10, Lot lifts his eyes towards Sodom. Now the men of Sodom were wicked, great sinners against the Lord. In verse 12, Lot settled among the cities of the valley and moved his tent as far as Sodom. He looks towards Sodom. He moves close to Sodom. Chapter 14, verse 12, they also took Lot, the son of Abram's brother, who was dwelling in Sodom. He looks towards Sodom. He moves his tent towards Sodom. Now he's dwelling in Sodom. By the time we're here, 22, 25 years later, Lot is sitting at the gate and he's enmeshed into the life of Sodom. There is an important lesson for us in these details. Psalm chapter 1, verse 1 says this: Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. Remember, I first heard this verse through another person's devotional, but I want you to see a progression there. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers. This is what happens to us when we're not careful. We start by walking in the way. We're in the vicinity. We're walking by. We're listening to, we're considering the counsel of the wicked. We go from walking in the counsel of the wicked to standing. We're no longer walking, we're standing in that place, becoming more a part of it. Finally, we take a seat. We sit in the seat of scoffers. Blessed is a man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers. There's a progression. Dear people, no one wakes up in the morning and says, today I'm going to throw my faith away. No one wakes up in the morning and says, today I am going to ruin my life. I'm going to walk away from God and I'm going to get enmeshed in the wickedness. Nobody wakes up in the morning and says, this is that day. We walk on by and take notice. We stay and converse a while. We interact with sin. We question the ways of God. And then we sit down and make ourselves at home. It happens piece by piece, step by step, compromise by compromise, seemingly little and maybe even to us innocent decisions. But where leads the decisions that we make? God is merciful to Lot on Abram's account. Two angels pull him out of the city reluctantly. It says in chapter 19, verse 16, though, that even while they're trying to warn him of judgment, he lingers there. Very interesting if you take the time to read it. He's instructed to go into the hills, but he negotiates. Lord, I don't want to go to that place. Let me go to this city instead. His wife seeks to return to Sodom and is lost in the judgment that follows. When last we see Lot, he is in the hills with his daughters. Too many years of living in Sodom, of raising a family enmeshed in the life of Sodom. Now understand, the Bible doesn't tell us that we're to hide ourselves from the sin of the world. We're not supposed to go away into seclusion, but we are to refrain from becoming participants within it and becoming enmeshed within it. Lot's life was a conflicted life. 2 Peter, we read this. If by turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah to ashes, he condemned them to extinction, making them an example of what is going to happen to the ungodly, and if he rescued righteous Lot, greatly distressed by the sensual conduct of the wicked, for as that righteous man lived among them day after day, he was tormenting his righteous soul over the lawless deeds that he saw and heard. Lot was a man of faith. Lot, someone that we will meet one day as believers. But Lot made some decisions that put him in a place that left his life in constant torment and tension. Not simply because he lived among the so-called wicked, but he was attracted to that wickedness. When he separated from Abram, He looked towards Sodom. He moved towards Sodom. He moved within Sodom. And he became enmeshed in the life of Sodom. It was a conflicted life. He knew better. But his decisions left a permanent mark, not just on his life, on his family. When we leave Lot, he's an old man living in the hills with his daughter, whose morality has been so infected by Sodom, they don't even see their morality for what it is. Each of them initiate a drunken, incestuous evening. And in his drunkenness, Lot doesn't even know what's happening. But the months that follow would tell the story. One child was named Moab, and the other Ben-Ammi, father of the Amorites. And for those who would have been reading these passages and hearing them for the first time, remember those Israelites around the campfire leaving Egypt to the promised land? The Moabites and the Ammonites would constantly battle against the Israelites. Constantly battle against the people of God in the Old Testament. So what? So what? I know I'm giving you lots of details, lots of history, lots of story this morning. So what? Where leads the decisions that you make? And how far-reaching are decisions made without faith or outside of faith? These two men present a cautionary tale. So what? Don't tell me when you play on the edges of sin. Don't tell me when you play on the edges of sin, when you look towards Sodom, when you move your tent towards Sodom, when you choose to live within and become enmeshed in the life of Sodom, when you walk in the counsel of the wicked, when you stand in the way of sinners, or when you sit in the seat of scoffers. Don't tell me that it's just about you. Don't tell me that it won't lead anywhere, that it won't hurt anybody, or that you can turn back anytime. Don't tell me that it won't affect your family or those around you and the values and the decisions that even your one day grown children will make and beyond them. Don't tell me that just a little bit of sin is about you. H.B. London, in writing to pastors on their need for integrity in their lives, speaks about those who begin flirting with the questionable, saying that those who flirt with the questionable, it almost always leads to moral shipwreck. Ravi Zacharias, he's quoting from an old cathedral song, and he writes this: sin will take you further than you want to go, keep you longer than you want to stay, and cost you more than you want to pay. The question I call on us to consider from this text today, of the decision of these two men, decisions made in the context of conflict, and sometimes our conflicts are even with ourselves, is where leads the decisions that you make? Not just the big ones, but daily decisions that are made from the vantage point of faith in God or made from the vantage point of grabbing and self-interest. Where we say to the world around us, to our families, to ourselves, to God, I deserve, I am owed, I owe it to myself. Just a little bit apart from faith, apart from my relationship with Christ, and I'll come back to it later. Each day, you and I are faced with decisions that reflect the life that we are building. Two houses built by two men experiencing the obstacle of a storm. And Jesus said, Everyone, then, who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on a rock. Did Lot ever think it was possible that he could return to Abram? Did Lot ever think it was possible that he could leave and go back? Why, after suffering and rescued by Abram once, did he not think, you know what, I'm in the wrong place. I'm engaged in the wrong activities. I need to move back and to be close to what God was doing. Now, I'm analogizing a little bit, but I think the point is valid. Is there a danger in spending too much time, too long in Sodom? I have seen families as a pastor over 22 years. I've seen families that have prioritized their life in this world over their faith in God. I have seen them do it in so many avenues with their families. And later they sit back and wonder as their kids hit college, why will their are their kids not walking with God? Why not? Although it's not universal, somebody once said, your kids may fail to listen to you, but they'll never fail to imitate you. That's not universal, but there is some truth to that. I know in my own life there's times that I have heard my own inappropriate tongue come out of the mouths of my kids. This is a cautionary sermon and a challenge. If you find that you have been flirting with the questionable, looking or even subtly moving your life a little bit closer to Sodom, don't think it's just about you, and don't think it's easy just to turn back one day. I want you to hear this message on the front end of maybe some of the decisions that you are engaged in at this moment. Not later when you're wasted in some cave thinking, why didn't anyone tell me? I want you to hear it at the front end. Where leads the decisions you make? It won't lead where you think. When you make decisions that are about grabbing and self, when you make decisions that are about how close can I get to Sodom, but still be of God. When you make those kind of decisions, it won't lead where you think. For every decision made outside of our faith in Jesus Christ is a decision that will eventually lead to regret. Let me say that one more time. We're coming to an end here in a minute. Every decision made outside of our faith in Jesus Christ is a decision that will eventually lead to regret. Maybe not right today, but it will nonetheless. For some of you, maybe it's time to come home. Maybe it's time to leave Sodom and find faith in Christ again. God's mercy, the cross of Christ, paves the way for us to return. God wouldn't leave Lot and Sodom. He literally, through two angels, grabbed them by the scruff of the neck and pulled them out. And that was God's mercy. But these are decisions that we make. The Bible says this, last verse I want to share. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. My little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. Where leads the decisions you are making today? Are they decisions out of faith or something else? Amen.
We're going to invite you to stand as we close our service this morning. Responding with, today I choose.
Today I choose to follow you. Today I choose. Give my yes to you today. I choose to hear your voice and live today. I choose to follow you. As for me and my house, we will serve you. As for me and my house, we will spend our lives on you today. Today will spend their lives on you. As for me and my house, we will serve you. As for me and my house, we will spend our lives on you today. A wonderful Counselor, Everlasting Father, Eternal King, Lord of Hosts, willingly we follow. You're a wonderful Counselor, Everlasting Father, Eternal King, Lord of Hosts, willingly we follow. Today I choose to follow you. Today I choose to give my yes to you. Today I choose to hear your voice and live. Today I choose to follow you. To follow you.
The purpose of your life is the glory of God. That is why you were created. That is why Christ came to save and rescue you, that we would live for the glory of God. But when we spend too much time not just living in Sodom, but really becoming part of Sodom, the way we think changes. And we don't always even realize the subtle things that are taking place in our spirit. That's why H.B. London's phrase really captured my attention this week. What it is to flirt with the questionable. And that might be a place that you're at right now. Or it might be a place that you're at, but your thinking has so changed that you don't even know it anymore. I invite you, as you go into this week, to pray as the psalmist prayed, asking the Spirit of God to speak into your heart. When he says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. And see if there be any grievous or wicked way in me. And lead me in the way everlasting." Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, now and forevermore. Amen.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love is amazing, steady and